Welcome to Game Theorem, where we have serious discussions about absurd entertainment.
Our world continued to be matriarchal upon superficial observation, but was subject to a cloaked form of patriarchal tyranny all along. Poor Amarium, sylph of space.
We're talking about Homestuck again.
Woo! This is our fourth Homestuck episode. It's the first time we've had a fourth revisit, so this is a new milestone for us. Because Homestuck is probably something we'll never stop talking about, because it's awesome.
Yeah, I'm Kira.
I'm Kyle. There will be spoiler warnings for Homestuck, of course. If you're not sure what Homestuck is, we've had previous episodes on it. Our first one was a general overview, so please go check that one out. Then we had one talking about all the different powers and god tiers and aspects and whatnot. And the third one was the history of Earth. That's going to be both a prequel and a sequel to this one, depending on where you're looking at in the chronology.
What can I say? Homestuck is complicated.
Exactly. To the point where, let me tell you about Homestuck is a meme.
Yep.
Now, Homestuck is kind of done. It's over. Although there is some spin-off content that comes out every so many years, right? Today, we really wanted to talk about trolls. Now, we have to give you some trigger warnings up ahead. This will be very much an explicit episode. There's going to be violence and language and this, the kind of stuff you would see in most of Homestuck.
But slight cannibalism.
Yes. But the thing that's going to be happening particularly with this episode is there's going to be a lot of discussion around sex.
Yep.
If you guys don't know, I don't really curse. Kira handles most of the cursing for me.
Yeah.
I was raised in a very puritanical environment. I was not supposed to say certain words. So I've been trying to get better at saying certain words. I haven't worked up to curse words. I don't know if I will. But this is probably the first time you've heard me actually say the word sex.
Yeah.
It's new for me. It's weird. I'm trying to not stigmatize it and reintroduce it into my vocabulary. Or introduce it for the first time, rather.
Yep. We're going to be talking a lot about troll biology and evolution.
Right. So, we're going to talk about the history of trolls, which are like an alien species, basically. We're going to be talking about their history. But before we can even do that, we have to talk about what trolls are in the context of Homestuck. They're an alien species that's introduced in this webcomic. But what are they? How do they work? Let's break that down first, and then it'll be easier to understand their history. Because one thing that Homestuck does really well is these aliens are only superficially similar to humans, because biologically they are extremely different.
Yeah.
It's so common in science fiction and media to have aliens that are just, oh, it's a Martian and they're similar to us, but slightly different, you know?
Yeah.
That is not the case here. Or it's the case only on the surface level until you dig deeper. So you want to go first, Kira?
All right, sure.
All right, let's break down troll biology and evolution.
Trolls are not simply aliens. They are the most powerful known species in a parallel universe that happened to evolve in such a way that superficially resembles humanity, which does not exist in this universe. You know, I thought there was an explanation for that, because aren't the trolls technically the gods of humanity? And so humanity technically resembles them, not the other way around.
More like, not really gods of, but rather they predated humanity.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you could argue that humanity is based off of them. But it is still the same argument no matter which way you're looking at it. And really the answer is just parallel universes that are similar to ours in certain ways and very different in other ways. It's the multiverse idea. Now, trolls live on a planet that has 26 months in a solar year, each of which is called a sweep. So when you talk about years, they don't have years, they have sweeps, and it's different because that's 26 months. It's a longer cycle.
Trolls seem to have evolved from amphibious insects that acquired many mammalian traits. They are hatched as larval wigglers that pupate before emerging into humanoid children that go on to grow into adults.
If you have any questions, Kira, feel free to ask me. Mm-hmm. I wrote the notes for this one. Occasionally, a special egg is laid called the matriorb that hatches into a mother grub. They are like queens of wiggler colonies, as sentient and intelligent as any troll, but they never pupate. They alone are able to lay eggs to produce more trolls, so they must be protected by the fully matured trolls.
In order for a mother grub to lay eggs, she must be supplied with genetic fluids from copulating trolls, meaning that trolls can have intercourse, but that is just the first step in their reproductive process.
Binary sex is vestigial in trolls, perhaps playing a role in reproduction in the distant past. Trolls have two reproductive fluids, one that is light and one that is dark, and all modern trolls are capable of expelling either during intercourse through a phallic genital organ on the pelvis known as the bone bulge. When not in use, it is barely noticeable, but when used, it can expand to a great size.
You had to extrapolate this from them using insults and
because I mean, they use very vulgar insults on their reproductive anatomy, kind of like, you know, we do, like with the F word and whatnot. But the gist of it is, when they're not using it, it's almost like a human female in the pelvic area.
I see.
There's no, you can, it's smooth. There's almost nothing bulging out, right? Mm-hmm. But when it is in use, then it's more male like. Mm-hmm. And human-wise.
Mm-hmm. While trolls are effectively sexless, trolls still have vestigial secondary sex characteristics, which in time culminated in gender as a social construct. Troll men and women are roughly equivalent to human men and women, but they never developed a concept of sexual orientation based on gender within their societies.
Yeah, so this is the kind of, like, we don't even see orientation kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And being what we would consider bi is very normalized, which is whatever. Mm-hmm. It's great representation, but, you know, I think it's better to write fiction that acknowledges orientation.
I would say they're actually all pan because they don't care about gender at all.
No, that's not true. They definitely have gender constructs. It's just not based entirely on sex.
Yeah, but their romance has nothing to do with gender.
No, but it assumes a gender binary, making them bisexual.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
Or bi-gender. Their orientation is focused on the two-gender system. Mm-hmm. Because of those secondary characteristics. It's, you know, illogical, but that's how societies worked, both for trolls and for humans.
Yeah.
The most notorious example of this biological dimorphism is that pseudo-female trolls have breasts, organs on the chest that are thought to have once been stingers to fend off predators.
That's weird.
Again, they superficially resemble humans, but they have no purpose of, you know, providing milk to children, so their breasts were for a completely different purpose.
You know, I think Hussey just thought he couldn't get rid of the concept of gender in troll society because they're going to be interacting with humans and stuff, and so he left them with the gender binary.
I think in actuality, I mean, it's two things. One, they were supposed to be much like humans, like your kind of typical science fiction alien, and then deviate when you actually learn about them, which means obviously they would have gender even if they don't necessarily have sex. Mm-hmm. Secondly, Hussey, the author, seemed to have kind of some blind spots about gender when he was first starting off Homestuck, and he rounded it out later on.
Mm-hmm. Like, it would make sense if all trolls were non-binary.
There are a few trolls that are non-binary, but very much like humanity, it is the exception.
Yeah. All right. When mother grubs have enough genetic fluids, they mix it into a slurry that it lays in the form of eggs. However, mother grubs can still lay eggs without the fluids. In such cases, the unfertilized eggs hatch into drones.
Yeah, this is a common misconception in the Homestuck fan base that drones are robotic. While there will be robot drones later on, the original ones are like ant drones or like insect drones. Mm-hmm. Unfertilized eggs. Mm-hmm. Drones pupate into barely sentient automata that serve matured trolls directly and mother grubs indirectly. They do the gathering of the genetic fluids for the trolls and deliver it to the mother grubs, but they do so as dictated by trolls in whatever society they have constructed.
Mm-hmm. Trolls involved symbiotic relationships with many beasts on their world. As troll children pupate and enter the world, they befriend one of these dangerous but protective beasts, who then raises the troll into adulthood.
The beasts evolved alongside trolls, and as parental figures, they became more intelligent, though not as much as the trolls they raised. Beasts that had been conditioned this way became known as lusus naturae. Naturally, they effortlessly outcompeted beasts that weren't luci to extinction.
Does that mean that when Nebita goes hunting, she kills luci?
It's not entirely clear whether all non-luci are extinct, but they are certainly less numerous.
Okay.
But yes, probable.
Most species on their world had a variety of blood colors due to quirks of their biology. Trolls have brains capable of spectacular psychic powers that exist on a spectrum that results in differing pigments in their blood. Thus, trolls exist on a hemispectrum, and Luci learn to identify compatible troll children based on that hemispectrum.
Yeah, so basically these Luci beasts come in many different blood colors. Trolls could be any blood color, and so they would start to pair off based on the color. Trolls would eventually classify the hemospectrum into 12 categories, each of which would be known by proper names, slang terms, racial slurs, and parts of social categories. Not only are psychic powers roughly correlated along the hemospectrum, but so are lifespans and amphibiousness, but they are inversely proportional to population. Therefore, the majority have psychic powers, but the minority live a very long time.
Burgundy Bloods have the shortest lifespans, only about a dozen sweeps, and are the strongest users of telekinesis.
Bronze Bloods have the ability to commune with beasts.
That's like only in your 20s.
Yes.
That's insane. Gold Bloods are powerful psionics that are capable of manipulating things at extreme speeds, some even not bound by the speed of light.
Yeah, so psychic powers aren't exactly limited by the laws of physics. Lion Bloods are the most powerful psychics of all, despite not being at the extreme end of the hemospectrum, seeming to violate the pattern.
Olive Bloods tend not to have psychic powers, but they can live a while.
Jade Bloods tend to bond with Mother Grubs, since Mother Grubs always have Jade Blood. After living in brooding caverns with Mother Grubs, Jade Bloods have since evolved the capacity to become rainbow drinkers. Few Jade Bloods tap into that potential through surviving fatal wounds and go on to emit phosphorescence and nourish themselves off of blood and genetic fluids of all kinds and colors. They are basically troll vampires.
Teal Bloods tend to live many dozens of sweeps.
Cerulean Bloods are the highest on the hemospectrum that can have psychic powers, with one exception, and it's incredibly rare. When they do, they are limited to manipulating the minds of other trolls.
Indigo Bloods never have psychic powers, but they tend to live hundreds of sweeps.
Purple Bloods are extremely resilient physically, and they have only one single psychic ability they can ever hope to obtain, called Chuckle Voodoo. They are the highest land-dwelling trolls on the hemospectrum.
Violet Bloods exhibit amphibious features that make them distinct as sea-dwelling trolls.
Fuchsia Bloods are sea-dwelling trolls with lifespans so long they've never been adequately measured. They are extremely rare, with only a few ever being known.
Drones always have black blood with no pigment whatsoever. In addition, they grow hardened plates on their skin, emulating an exoskeleton.
Mature trolls superficially resemble humans, but there are some notable anatomical differences, including sharp but omnivorous teeth and horn protrusions through the skull, or think pan, that can grow to huge sizes in a variety of ways. Trolls are also nocturnal, with gray skin and yellowish eyes, and find ultraviolet light painful.
Their eyes have a yellow sclera, which is the white part normally on our eyes, and then their eye color fills in with their blood color as they get older.
As they get older, though, when they're young, it doesn't.
Yeah, when they're young, and they don't have a color. Because of the complicated collective reproductive systems of trolls, mutations are relatively common. Various mutations include more powerful psychic abilities than is typically expected of one's blood color, blood colors that exist outside of the human spectrum entirely, the growth of vestigial insect wings, and a resilience to ultraviolet light. Rarely, mutant drones have been known to exist that were incredibly intelligent and gargantuan.
Because of their reproductive system, trolls would develop a more complicated sense of love via the quadrant system. A heart represented matespreadship, which was a positive and sexual love. A spade represented kismicitude, which was a negative and sexual love. A diamond represented moral allegiance, which was a positive and friendly love. A club represented auspicism, which was a negative and bickering love, usually with a mediator.
All right.
I think we went deeper into that on our first Homestuck episode.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's what trolls are. That's how they work. Any questions, Kira?
Nah.
All right. Now we all know about how they make babies.
Yeah.
Well, they don't make babies. How they make larvae. Okay, so let's talk about their history. We have to talk about their original history, the A1 timeline.
Billions of sweeps ago, a first guardian landed on a planet called Before Us in the A1 universe via a meteor from a spurb session, the interdimensional game that connects universes. Its exact nature was unknown, but it watched over the planet. Before Us had a pink moon that had a pink moonlet.
Through the millennia, trolls and Lucy evolved on Before Us. They developed many languages that were analogous to those on Earth. East Beforean was a language equivalent to Google Translate Japanese, but most spoke Trollian, which could be recognized vocally as equivalent to English. However, Trollian used the modified Daedric alphabet. So basically, if you heard them speak, it would sound to you like English because, again, parallel universes, but they write it in a completely different alphabet.
Mm-hmm. Trolls also developed astrology based on 48 constellations they determined in the night sky. However, they created their own, extended zodiac, that functioned an entirely different purpose. They were a library of hundreds of signs that denoted one's place on the human spectrum and spiritual disposition.
Feferi Paishis was a troll who became the Empress of Before Us, and under her rule, she ensured that society prospered under a unified rule. She used the hemospectrum to identify social classes of privilege for the purpose of providing social welfare by the high bloods to the low bloods.
Trolls thus lived in a peaceful society, though many specifics are lost to history.
That's pretty cool, right?
Mm-hmm.
Social welfare and whatnot. 7 sweeps ago, several more meteors from a spurb session crashed into Before Us, each carrying a Wiggler that was a paradox clone of themselves. 12 Wigglers were adopted into Beforean society across the Hemo spectrum.
The Wigglers included...
Oh, do you want me to pronounce their names?
I know how to pronounce their names.
Okay. I just... When it was Pokemon, you asked me to do it, so I thought...
I got the Homestuck names.
Okay.
The Wigglers included Mina Paishis, the Fuchsia Blood, Cronus Empora, the Violet Blood, Kurlaz Makara, the Purple Blood, Horus Zahak, the Indigo Blood, Arania Circuit, the Cerulean Blood, Latula Pyrope, the Teal Blood, Por Mariam, the Jade Blood, Mulan Leon, the Olive Blood, Matuna Captor, the Gold Blood, Rufio Nitrum, the Bronze Blood, Damara Megiddo, the Burgundy Blood, and Kinkri Vantis, who was not on the Hemis Spectrum, instead of having Candy Red Blood.
Right, you got all of it right except for Aranea Sirket, the Cerulean Blood.
Aranea? Oh, okay.
You said it differently. Anyway, after pupating, each child was adopted by a corresponding Lucis, except for Kinkri. New Lucis shared his blood color. So Porum instead raised him, being his adoptive guardian, despite being the same age. It's like a older sister kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. As an adult, Porum became a sex-positive feminist activist who opposed the patriarchy. She argued even though Beforus was technically a matriarchy under the Empress, most of the high bloods that served her were men, leading to systemic discrimination. Kinkri grew rebellious in his adolescence and then adulthood, trying to spitefully outdo Porum by becoming an activist for nearly all social issues like racism, hemotypism, geneticism, ableism, ageism, homophobia, transphobia, and everything except for feminism.
Yeah, so he's like the opposite of a white feminist. He believes in racism, but he doesn't believe in feminism. And it's literally just to spite her.
Yeah.
Like people act like Kankri's annoying and that he's hypocritical and whatnot. And I think to a certain extent with his turning a blind eye, he is. But on the issues he champions, he has a point. He is right. It's just the stuff he ignores, the stuff he overlooks. It's like he's cherry-picking the bigotries.
Mm-hmm.
Although, I guess, to use the cherry-picking analogy, he picked almost every cherry out of that bush, but he left a few because of some resentment he holds towards his pseudo-mother. Purim. He's the only one to even have something that would be called a mother.
Yeah.
Anyway, less than one sweep ago, Mina was deemed a potential heiress due to her fuchsia blood, and the Empress chose her as her successor because they shared the same zodiac sign. Mina, however, felt overwhelmed at the duties she would need to perform as the Empress, caring for all other trolls on Bephorus via social responsibility.
Instead of approaching the Empress to be groomed for her role, Mina stole a spaceship and escaped to the Pink Moon, where she found a meteor impact site and superb ruins.
Mina was friends with the other trolls that had crashed into Bephorus long ago. She communicated with her friends over the internet to decode the runes on the ruins. Matuna did most of the work, though he translated the name of the game as Scrub instead of Spurb. The 12 trolls launched the game of Scrub, which brought the world to ruin as it was pelted with meteors into a volcanic wasteland.
Hundreds of sweeps into the future, exiled Carapacians from the Scrub session attempted to recolonize the ruins of Bephorus. Eventually, the universe imploded into a singularity.
And that's the end of the story. No more. Yeah, there we go. Okay, we're done. Bye. I'm kidding. No, that was just the first iteration of a timeline, because here's how the game goes in bit of summary.
Mm-hmm.
In the A1 game session of Scrub, remember, this is the interdimensional game that connects all the universes and everything.
Mm-hmm.
The 12 trolls failed their session of Scrub spectacularly and turned to bickering and fighting amongst each other. After spending a whole sweep there, they enacted the Scratch that reset the game so that trolls would have a second chance of success. In so doing, history was reset, with some altered settings specifically involving the meteor impacts. The 12 trolls that played the game would play the part of ancestors in the new timeline, whereas their 12 ancestors would play the part of the players.
It was thought that trolls would get a chance to prepare more the second time around to succeed at the game, but this was false. The A1 trolls had learned in their session that the meteors that had carried the wigglers of themselves and their ancestors had not originated from this session, but the future reset version of their session, implying that they had been doomed to failure all along, doomed to reset, like their existence was just the pretense to a do-over.
Such a paradoxical inconsistency in Scrub would be known as the glitch, defined by the fact that this universe would be claimed by a powerful, indestructible demon called Lord English. He was a former Scrub player from a different universe in the far future, but this universe would be his plaything. As the Lord of Time, he could be any time he wanted, commanding the timeline consistencies to work around his selfish desires.
All right.
So he's basically like, this universe is mine, and everything up till now has just been a pretense for a do-over.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now we're going to be in the A2 timeline, the new one, the one that's very sad and bad and terrible.
Yeah. The glitch that doomed the A2 universe resulted in a broken law of physics. Occasionally, physical items would manifest an attribute called object duality, where one object would in fact be two separate objects, switching between one state to the other anytime it is observed.
Yeah, so there's this one character who has a lipstick/chainsaw. Mm-hmm. So it's like, go pick up the lipstick. Okay, chainsaw somebody. Go pick up the chainsaw. Okay, applies the lipstick. Billions of sweeps ago, Doc Scratch, a first guardian, landed on the troll planet in the A2 universe via a meteor from a new Scrub session. He was an enhanced Paradox clone of two Jujus, Little Cal and a Q-Ball. Jujus are artifacts that have fallen into physical ontological paradoxes, thereby becoming themselves. By necessity, they never age, and can never be destroyed, or their time loop would be severed.
Doc Scratch was an upright puppet man with a cue ball for a head. He branched off from Lil' Cal as a separate entity, now with godly first guardian abilities, as well as a near-omniscient intellect granted by the intellect put within Lil' Cal and then recursively made by the cue ball. His omniscience allowed him to know the past, present, and future of his timeline within his universe, with the only limits to his foresight being alternate timelines and Heroes of Void from Scrub.
Yeah, so this like omniscience with an asterisk. He knows everything that will ever happen in this timeline, with the exception of those troublesome void players, because their whole void aspect is like the lack of knowing. So that's not good. This first guardian, like if you listen to the Earth episode where the last one where we talked about Earth, the first guardian was like a dog or a cat. In this one, you have Puppet Man.
Yeah.
Notice how I put his universe.
Yeah.
Right. Doc Scratch both knew and planned out his schemes for the entire future, with the express purpose of serving his master, Lord English. His master wanted to seize the troll's reward of beating the next scrub session, and his master felt they could only do it by being more violent.
Doc Scratch spent most of the early eras of evolution constructing an additional moon around the planet. In addition to the Pink Moon and Pink Moonlet, he eventually created the Green Moon, from where he and Lord English watched the world. Lord English also brought along his henchmen, a group of leprechauns gifted with absurd time-traveling abilities.
We won't go into all of their absurdity. Doc Scratch genetically engineered a creature of his own design that could be used to sow violence and power amongst the trolls. Horror terrors were outer gods that existed outside and between universes. And Doc Scratch engineered a fuchsia-blooded miniature version of a horror terror that was also a Lucis, named Glob Glob.
Isn't it pronounced like Glub Glub?
Basically, but more creepy. And yeah, outer gods, you might be like, whoa, that came from out of nowhere. Well, it's a thing in Homestuck. It's not exactly important. But basically, given he's omniscient, he knew that they existed. He knew they were a thing.
Mm-hmm. Glub Glub was the size of a city and fully aquatic.
No, only the size. It was a small one.
Okay. Glub Glub was only the size of a city and fully aquatic. It possessed psychic powers stronger than any troll. If it ever became upset, it would wail, psychically killing trolls, starting at the lower end of the humus spectrum.
Doc Scratch felt that fulfilling his master's wishes would be far too easy for an omniscient man, so he added a personal challenge. He promised to never tell a lie, save for jokes, which he considered only very temporary lies, and pranks, which he and his master enjoyed. But technically, he would never lie. His first prank was subtly manipulating the trolls to name the planet Alternia, instead of Bephorus.
Why?
Because, like, Bephorus, Alternia, like, they changed the timeline, get it?
Oh, I see. While Doc Scratch was capable of intervening for more direct methods of intervention, he preferred not to do so personally. This problem was solved in the far future, and Lord English's personal assassin, gifted with his abilities of time travel, would appear whenever needed to ensure the timeline stayed on track.
Trolls mythologized what little they knew of Lord English as death itself, and his assassin became known as the Handmaid. Few would know of Doc Scratch's involvement.
Doc Scratch still enjoyed manipulating behind the scenes personally. Since he knew the future, he considered reality but a game to be played, and that playing would be a reward unto itself.
He loved to dance the dance, so he would say. Doc Scratch created what he called seeds, which were standalone cue balls that he distributed among Alternia in secret. Anyone who could manage to peer inside one would be able to ask any question that would be truthfully answered. They caused their share of chaos, but they were forgotten in time as trolls advanced to more modern ages.
In time, trolls began advancing technologically, even developing an alternative to the modified Daedric alphabet called the New Alternian Alphabet.
One that's not as liable to copyright. Thousands of sweeps ago, the first of the scrub meteors crashed into Alternia, carrying Mina. Glub Glub became her Lucis and raised her. And in time, when she matured, Mina would take care of Glub Glub, making sure she was fed a steady diet of other Luci so that she would never make a sound nor endanger anyone. Because remember, if she makes a sound, trolls die.
Yep. Mina realized that she could weaponize Glub Glub as a threat to secure power. She made it known that if Glub Glub were to scream, she would emit the vast glub, which would emanate until it killed every troll in the universe, aside from fuchsia bloods like herself.
Mina seized power over the Sea Dwellers and became known as her imperious condescension. She waged a war against the Land Dwellers, who were led by the religious Highbloods, who believed the Sea Dwellers belonged at the bottom of the Hemo Spectrum, not the top. Because remember, it's kind of a cycle, in a way.
Mm-hmm. The Highbloods consisted mostly of Purple Bloods, and they enforced an orthodoxy of religion upon the Land Dwellers that would superficially resemble Juggalo culture. They revered the Merfolk Messiahs, two deities representing duality and opposites, that would originate from a dark carnival to one day take trolls to the Paradise Planet.
And yes, if you're like, alien Juggalos, really? No, the story says that the Juggalos were actually inspired from the trolls. Listen to our last episode, you'll see.
Yeah.
The Highbloods ruled in the image of the Mirthful Messiahs, and in so doing, they were led by two Grand Highbloods at any given time. This often wasn't the most effective form of governance, but they reveled in the chaos.
The Sea Dweller War. The Land Dwellers were much more powerful and numerous than the Sea Dwellers, but the Sea Dwellers had three advantages. The ability to retreat to the sea, long lifespans for the development of tactical plans, and Glub Glub. The Condess wheeled Glub Glub as a threat against the Land Dwellers. She didn't want to actually use her to kill them all, but the Highbloods believe she was seriously willing to do so.
Because she seemed that unhinged.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Condess and the Sea Dwellers won the war. The Condess consolidated her power over all trolls and enforced a strict class hierarchy. She ruled, and Violet Bloods were the aristocracy. The Purple Bloods were the enforcers of authority, and they delegated to the classes below, until the Low Bloods would all find that slavery was not just common, but the norm.
The Condess set up a judicial system with a single judge, an enormous throne known as His Honorable Tyranny. Various legislacerators could appear before him in court, but the system was designed to discourage leniency in execution.
It was barely a court, it was just executions.
Yep.
In time, other scrub meteors crashed into Alternia, carrying Cronus, Kurlos, Horus, Aranea, and Porum. They individually managed to survive, pupate, find Luci, and mature and integrate into society.
Cronus integrated into Violet Blood Aristocracy. Cronus integrated into Violet Blood Aristocracy as a privateer who specialized in hunting pirates and Luci, earning him the moniker of Orphaner Jewel Scar.
Because he was hunting Luci every time he killed one, that meant there was an orphan out there somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Because a troll didn't have their pet parent. Kurlos rose to prominence among the Purple Blood subjugulators. His brutality and duality were so great that he was simultaneously appointed to both grand positions to rule the Land Dwellers at the same time on the Condess's behalf. Though they normally were ruled by two Highbloods, Kurlos would become uniquely known singularly as the Grand Highblood. He was both things.
Mm-hmm. Horus integrated into Indigo Blood Military, where he was a loyal soldier and hobbyist machinist. He became known as Executor Darklear.
Aranea went her own way. A very manipulative Cerulean Blood psychic, she changed her name and became the most notorious pirate on Alternia, known as Marquise Spinneret Mindfang. In truth, however, her success was due in part because Doc Scratch had selected her to be his protege. He liked young women and wanted to interfere with her life personally, and she used what information he divulged to her advantage. He was so creepy about that. He's like, I like interfering with young women. They're like, but that's creepy because of how old you are. He's like, well, I'm millions of years old. Every woman I'm going to meet is young.
Yeah. Mindfang was friends with Darklear, and he revealed to her that he had a cue ball. His latent scrub abilities as the Page of Void made this one of the few facts Doc Scratch did not know, shrouding him from his omniscience. She used her psychic vision to ask questions of the cue ball, to which it always answered correctly. However, she was unnerved when she asked it how she would eventually die at the hands of the summoner.
Right, so everything that happens now after, Mindfang literally knows who's going to be killing her.
Mm-hmm.
Hundreds of sweeps ago, Porum integrated into Jade Blood Society, where she was confined to the brooding caverns to care for the mother grubs and direct the drones. She became known as the Dolorosa, and she was usually forbidden to see the surface. However, while on a rare trip to the surface during an errand, she encountered a scrub meteor impact with the mutant wiggler, Kankri.
The Dolorosa knew no Lucius would accept Kankri and that he was sure to die with no one to care for him. Many popular dishes on Alternia, like grub sauce, were even made using defective wigglers. So she decided to abandon her duties and care for Kankri herself, knowing that she could be executed for violating the social norm.
Right, so we see the same scenario from before happening again, but now there's a much bigger age difference.
Mm-hmm.
And the world is a lot more persecutional.
Yeah.
Around the same time, other scrub meteors crashed into Alternia, carrying Latula, Mulan, and Mituna. They individually managed to survive, pupate, find Lucy, mature, and attempted to integrate into society.
As fugitives, the Dolorosa raised Kankri, but he was the first to realize he retained scrub powers from his previous life in the last session as the Seer of Blood. He saw visions of his life on Bepharis, and though he didn't fully understand them, he wept at the beauty of the idea that trolls could be peaceful.
Yeah, he saw the visions of the previous timeline, where everything was like a socialist utopia. As an adult, Kankri began preaching sermons on love and equality to trolls of all bloods, building a following that opposed the current social order. For his teachings and his mutant blood color, he became known as the Sufferer. His most loyal followers included his mother, the Dolorosa, as well as two others.
Most Goldbloods were enslaved to use their psionic powers to power vessels and machines, but Mituna escaped enslavement. His psychic powers were so strong that he became known as the Psionic. He and the Sufferer became best friends.
Mulan, however, was the Sufferer's most devoted follower, earning her the moniker of the Disciple. She and the Sufferer began a relationship that cast aside the quadrant system entirely.
The Sectarian War. After the Sufferer's movement gained momentum, a full-on revolution followed as the Lowbloods revolted against their oppressors. The Linebloods were by far the biggest threat with their powerful psychic powers, despite being in the middle of the human spectrum. Therefore, the threat of Glubglub did not impede this revolution.
Exactly, because Glubglub starts off at the low end, but the Linebloods, remember, they violated the pattern by having such psychic powers in the middle of the human spectrum. Mm-hmm. So that gives them a real advantage that hasn't been utilized up to this point.
Yep. The Sufferer's relationship with the Disciple casting aside the quadrant system. The phrase casting aside the quadrant system is often used to indicate that it was a more human relationship that had all kinds of love in it.
I mean, kind of, but most human relationships fall squarely into the heart, otherwise known as maestritship.
I guess.
It's just a non-conforming type of love. It's not really that complicated.
The Condes, recognizing the threat the Linebloods posed to toppling her rule, ordered a concentrated effort not on the revolution, but instead on the manual and systematic genocide of the Linebloods. Violet, Purple, Indigo, Cerulean, and some Tealbloods orchestrated the murders of millions of Linebloods until the color and caste were erased from existence and history.
Yeah, and that thereby pretty much eliminated them from the gene pool. No Linebloods will ever be born again.
Mm-hmm.
Genocide bad. The Condes is terrible.
Mm-hmm.
Without the Linebloods to assist, the remaining revolutionary forces were beaten into submission, and the war was lost. The upper classes set out to capture, enslave, or execute the defeated, but the Condes wanted an example to be set for the Sufferer and his closest followers.
The Condas enslaved the psionic and incorporated him into the core of her spaceship. She developed a fondness for him and used her latent scrub abilities as the Witch of Life to extend the psionic's lifespan so that he would live and power her ship for as long as she lived.
That's the thing about the Condas. She was already a fuchsia blood, which means she will never die of old age. But also, as a scrub player or a latent scrub player, she has Witch of Life powers, meaning she can give life to others if she sees fit.
Mm-hmm.
Small correction, the Condess was the Thief of Life. Fairy was the Witch of Life. Got them mixed up. Sorry about that. The Sufferer was put in shackles that resembled a now extinct Limeblood sign for his execution, and he was whipped and slashed so that all could see his mutant blood. Before his execution, his calm demeanor gave way to blinding rage, where he condemned and forgave trolls using the word
fuck
many times. The last of those words would be known as the Vast Expletive, and he was executed by Executor Darklear.
Executor Darklear was also tasked with executing the Disciple not long after. Though he had already executed her beloved, Darklear couldn't bring himself to kill her. Filled with regret, he let her go, and she fled. Expatriate Darklear was exiled for his cowardice, though he never expressed his express regret for his decision. Expatriate?
Yeah.
Did he change his name after he was
exiled? Yeah, he changed his name from Executor Darklear to Expatriate Darklear.
Ah, okay, cool.
Honestly, I feel proud of that. I wish he hadn't killed the Sufferer, but you know someone else would have, right?
Yeah, I mean, it was a spectacle.
Exactly. He was able to get away with not killing the Disciple, sort of. I mean, he lost his society and position. But, I mean, he's probably the highest-ranking person in the entire story to go against the Social Order, even if it was only a single time.
Mm-hmm.
The Dolorosa was sold into slavery, eventually falling into the possession of pirates. The Disciple, meanwhile, retreated into a cave where she tirelessly re-recorded her beloved sermons for future generations.
The Disciple thus founded a cult of the Followers of the Signless. The shackles he had worn were depicted as a symbol grayed out to represent the iron that had bound him and as an effort to conceal blood color. Mentioning the Signless was punishable by death, so the Followers of the Signless operated in secret. While they would use the cancer symbol to remember the Signless, that sign became commonly used by trolls to symbolize anonymity and resistance to the Social Order.
For the record, you might see parallels of the Signless now, and Jesus. And not only that, but the Dolorosa was kind of like the Virgin Mary.
That's on purpose.
Yeah, so like when the trolls will talk to the humans, they'll be like, do you even have a troll Jesus? And they'll be like, actually, we kind of do. The Followers of the Signless worship the second coming of the Signless, as his sermons predicted from his visions. They would persevere in hiding in the hopes of seeing the second coming.
Dualscar hunted down Mindfang, but in doing so, the two became kismeses, as the rivalry blossomed into a relationship. They'd antagonize each other, but they'd always both allow the other to get away.
The rivalry escalated as one day, during a naval battle between Mindfang and Dualscar, Mindfang stole some of Dualscar's slaves, one of which was the Dolorosa. She had the Dolorosa strip, and she sexually assaulted her on the deck of her ship, so that Dualscar could plainly see from his neighboring ship. Okay, this was actually really bad, because they described it as like a matesprit kind of thing, even though she was literally assaulting her.
Are you sure that this was the way they were stolen? I thought Dualscar stole the Dolorosa.
Well, that's how Dualscar originally got her.
Oh, okay.
She's just being, like, passed around. She's property.
Okay. Dualscar was incredibly jealous of Mindfang's actions, particularly because he himself had a crush on the Condas and had never taken action on it.
You're not going to be able to get with the Condas.
Mm-hmm.
Just not going to happen. And if you did, you probably would regret it.
Mm-hmm.
Dualscar felt that Mindfang had taken their rivalry too far, and so he ordered her ship attacked and arranged for the Dolorosa to be assassinated. At this, Mindfang ended their kismicitude relationship, and the fight between Mindfang and Dualscar became increasingly ferocious as their naval battles became less performative.
Dulskar raised the bounty to capture or kill Mindfang. He approached the Grand High Blood to ask for their assistance. However, he demanded that Dulskar be able to tell a funny joke before he would consider the offer. Dulskar never managed to even tell a decent joke, and the Grand High Blood decapitated him in his rage.
Yeah, it's often said that Dulskar's ending was in itself a joke.
Yeah.
The Grand High Blood still did honor Dulskar's last request. Lachula had become a notorious legislacerator under the new name Neophyte Red Glare. She believed in law and order under the current system, but secretly, she was also a follower of the Signless. The Grand High Blood asked her to track down Mindfang and bring her to court.
Mindfang learned that Red Glare was hunting her, but she deemed her a teal blood bureaucrat that was of no significance. However, Red Glare had a rare dragon Lucius named Pyrospite. She and Pyrospite ambushed Mindfang, tore off her arm, blinded her in one eye, captured her, and brought her to court.
Yeah, she did not fare very well in that fight.
Mm-hmm.
She did not go against a dragon, or she had not gone against a dragon before, you know? Mm-hmm. She was not prepared. So when Red Glare was preparing to make an opening statement to the court, Mindfang used her manipulative psychic powers to turn the onlooking crowd against Red Glare. They hanged her. In order to escape, however, Mindfang had to kill his honorable tyranny, and she fled to hide out with Darklear.
Darklear helped Mindfang recover, and he constructed a cybernetic arm for her. He told her of his sacrifice of status to save the disciple, and she began to reconsider her values in life, thinking often of the day she would die. She decided to take her most treasured weapons, the Flore Octet and Ahab's crosshairs, along with Darklear's cue ball, and safeguard them for the coming of her ancestor, something else that she had learned from Doc Scratch. Ahab's crosshairs was actually something she stole from Orphaner Dulskar, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's how she got it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, she stole all of her weapons. None of them were ones that she had originally.
Yeah.
Another scrub meteor crashed into Alternia, carrying Rufio. He managed to survive pupate Finalusus Mature and attempted to integrate into the Cavalreapers of the military. He was a bronze blood with powerful psychic abilities that let him commune with beasts. When he revealed his winged mutation to the soldiers, he inspired them to coordinate another rebellion against the Condes, much like the Signless had so long ago.
The Summoner's Rebellion. Mindfang, now a changed person, became a powerful ally of Rufio, who became known as the Summoner. They even became mate spritz. The rebellion proved to be a challenge to the Condes, as the Summoner communed with Lucy to turn them against the High Bloods, even commanding Red Glare's old Lucius Pyrospite himself.
However, the Condes had developed space fleets that ended the war, further dashing the people's hopes of revolution. Mindfang was fatally wounded, and the Summoner put her out of her misery. He was never seen again. Like, she spent her whole life terrified he would be the one to kill her, and it turns out it was putting her out of her misery.
Mm-hmm. The Condes realized that revolutions would keep being brought against her from the poorer regions of Alternia if she didn't act. She decided to completely restructure their society under the guise of an imperial campaign to conquer the galaxy. Every adult was forcibly conscripted into the military and banished from Alternia. They would be sent to other worlds to conquer them. Troll society was now a fully fascist regime.
Anything you want to say about that?
I mean, not surprising.
Fascism.
Yay.
Why does it keep coming up? Due to the enslavement of psionic goldbloods, they were able to avoid speed of light limitations and seek out alien species. They spread their fascist imperialism to many alien species throughout the galaxy as they discovered and subjugated them. The Condes, with her spaceship still powered by the psionic, was often the first to reach new species and personally arrange their assimilation into her empire.
Meanwhile, Alternia was firmly cemented as the homeworld, and it was protected as the breeding planet for trolls. Only children, wigglers, drones, lucii, and mother grubs lived on Alternia, where they would be forcibly conscripted upon reaching 9 sweeps old. Reproduction nearly became automated.
22 sweeps ago, it was rare, but occasionally a fuchsia blood would be born, and in time, another was, named Trizza Tethys. Usually, the younger fuchsia blood would declare herself the heiress and challenge the ruler for supremacy. But the Condes never lost a challenge.
However, the Condess was far away in space. While she received word that an heiress had been born, she didn't bother ceasing her imperial campaign for a challenge to the throne that she felt would be a waste of time, so she procrastinated dealing with the heiress.
Yeah, so she's just not going to bother with it right now. You know, I should mention that if it wasn't for the societal structure, fuchsia blood might be considered a mutant blood color. Because it's so rare, it might as well be, right? Mm-hmm. But because the Condess has cemented her rule, it's considered the peak of the hemo spectrum. Mm-hmm. Or I guess you could say the same thing in the original timeline.
Yep.
15 sweeps ago, the heiress consolidated power on Alternia, ruling over the children, young adults, and the drones. She exerted her rule as an open challenge to the Condess, and Glub Glub took a liking to her, becoming her Lucis. She also considered herself hilarious, demanding that everyone laugh at her jokes. Mm-hmm. What is it with people and humor?
The heiress sent drones to call two trolls one day named Zephyrus Trito and Tetrarch Domek. In an effort to escape, Domek activated a chair portal that he had found. It opened a portal that made him swap places with his corresponding chair portal in another universe. Domek swapped places with a human named Joey and became trapped on Earth prior to its destruction.
Yeah, that's a whole other unrelated story. It would take like five acts of a video game to tell it. In time, the Condess got around to putting an end to the heiress challenging her rule.
6 sweeps ago, the 12 scrub meteors that would belong to the players of the next scrub session crashed onto Alternia.
The Wigglers included Feferi Pacis, the Fuchsia Blood, Aridin Empora, the Violet Blood, Gamzee Makara, the Purple Blood, Equius Sahak, the Indigo Blood, Vriska Circuit, the Cerulean Blood, Terezi Pyrope, the Teal Blood, Kanaya Mariam, the Jade Blood, Nepeta Leon, the Olive Blood, Solix Captor, the Gold Blood, Tavros Nitram, the Bronze Blood, Aradia Megiddo, the Burgundy Blood, and Karkat Vantis, who was not on the Hemo Spectrum, instead having Candy Red Blood. So these are very similar to the last group. These are the ancestors, but now they're the player characters. It's all been reversed.
Mm-hmm. They individually managed to survive, pupate, find Lucy, and attempted to integrate into Alternian society. They all picked the same signs as their ancestors, each of them looking up to their ancestors. This shaped their development as they idolized their ancestors in their youth.
The followers of the Signless saw Karkat as the Second Coming, and they had prepared. They genetically engineered a Lucis that would accept his blood color, known as Crab Dad. Meanwhile, Glub Glub took a liking to Feferi, becoming her Lucis. Glub Glub just does not have any loyalty for Fuchsia.
No, absolutely not. As a child, Kanaya saw Doc Scratch standing in the desert during the day. When she walked towards him to see him, she realized she had a mutation that allowed her to be in ultraviolet daylight. This would be the second time Doc Scratch stood on Alternia since his youth.
Doc Scratch contacted Vriska and made her his new protege, just like he had done with Mindfang. He was not aware, however, that she had found Darklear's cue ball, still shrouded with void. She used it to get an edge on Doc Scratch, who was not used to trolls being so knowledgeable.
Aradia was an amateur archaeologist who discovered scrub ruins near where she lived. Her friend Solix decoded the runes and learned to code video games.
Solix's first work was a dangerous augmented reality game called FLARP, which became popular on Alternia. Tavros and Aradia teamed up as Team Charge, while Vriska and Terezi teamed up as Team Scourge.
During one game of FLARP, Vriska pushed Tavros to a cliff's edge. Instead of losing or becoming injured, he wanted to admit defeat. Doc Scratch appeared before Aradia and Terezi to distract them from helping Tavros. Vriska used her manipulative psychic powers to force Tavros to make a move, resulting in him falling off the cliff and becoming paralyzed from the waist down.
Aradia spent her whole life listening to the voices of the dead. She wasn't aware they were voices of her future selves from doomed timelines. In an act of vengeance, she tormented Vriska with the voices, who Vriska interpreted as the voices of all the trolls she had killed while FLARPing.
Doc Scratch advised Vriska to continue the cycle of revenge, so she manipulated Aradia's mate-sprit Solix into blasting his psionic abilities into Aradia, murdering her. In response, Terezi told Doc Scratch that Vriska had been cheating with one of his cue balls.
Doc Scratch became angry for the first time in his life. In a rage, he detonated the cue ball, while Vriska was consulting it in a green fire. She lost her arm and became blind in one eye, just like Mindfang.
Vriska, seething with vengeance for all of her friends, enacted a plan she called the Psychic Double Reach Around. She took control over Tavros and then used his communion powers to control Terezi's Lucis, who was a fetal dragon still inside its egg. The dragon was psychically linked to Terezi, and so Vriska used that to persuade Terezi to stare into the sun until she went blind herself.
All that complication to blind her in revenge. Mm-hmm. Terezi, Tavros, and Solix didn't continue the cycle of revenge anymore as they dealt with their severe physical and emotional trauma that Vriska had dealt. Aradia still was fated to play Scrub, and her psychic influence continued to live on as a projection that would be called by others as a ghost.
With no one willing to flirt with her anymore, Vriska took to real-world pirating. She and Aradin became kismeses as they reenacted the rivalry between Mindfang and Dualscar of long ago. Vriska kidnapped trolls to feed their Lucius, Spider-Mom, while Aradin captured their Lucide to feed Fafairi's Lucius, Glub Glub. Eventually, Vriska broke up with Aradin because she felt he was too needy.
Less than one sweep ago, Solix became a skilled programmer, and he eventually managed to decode the Scrub rune so they could play the game Scrub. He also created some dangerous viruses for fun that would affect the physicality of the universe using Scrub technology. Because remember, Scrub is a game that affects the universe, so he was able to make some of his own programs.
Mm-hmm. The programming that Solix used was known as ATH.
It's pronounced Till Death. It's a tilled ATH, Till Death.
Oh, okay. The programming that Solix used was known as Till Death, that functioned entirely on self-terminating paradoxes. The code only functioned on cyclical scripts.
Karkat ran Solix's Mobius Double Reach-Around virus that would curse the user to have people die around them in two universes.
Solix found a Till Death program on what he considered an unhackable server. He didn't know it, but it existed far outside of their universe, with its main loop tied to the lifespan of the universe. The code allowed for a demon, Lord English, to enter the universe upon its death. Because of time travel, however, Lord English was already here.
That's his thing. The 12 trolls eventually launched the game of Scrub, which brought the world to ruin as it was pelted with meteors into a volcanic wasteland. The Condess received word that the homeworld was under attack, and she immediately headed back to Alternia.
Fafairi and Solix were the last trolls to enter the game, but a meteor struck Glub Glub, killing her. As she died, she released the vast Glub, killing every troll in the universe aside from the Condess and Fafairi. Fafairi then entered the game.
So now their entire species is dead. With a psionic dead, the Condess could only travel through space at a measly light speed, and it would be a long time before she would arrive at Alternia.
Hundreds of sweeps in the future. Exiled care patients from the Scrub Session attempted to recolonize the ruins of Alternia. A group of former care patient agents formed a gang called the Midnight Crew, consisting of Spade Slick, Diamond Strug, Hertz Boxcars, and Clubs Deuce, each representing a card suit. They rebuilt civilization in the form of a shady Noor town, and they had an arsenal of object duality weapons in the form of cards.
Lord English's leprechauns decided to also colonize the surface. They formed a gang called the Felt, building the Felt Manor on Alternia near the Midnight Crew's town. Lord English was considered the boss of the gang, but Doc Scratch preferred to stay anonymous.
Each member of the Felt represented a billiards instrument. Lord English was the cue stick, while Doc Scratch was the cue ball. Balls 1 through 7 were Itchy, Doze, Trace, Clover, Finn, Die, and Crowbar. Balls 9 through 15 were Stitch, Sawbuck, Matchsticks, Eggs, Biscuits, Quarters, and Cans. They were missing an 8 ball, but Doc Scratch aimed to fix that.
Doc Scratch recruited a banished quasi-royal Carapacian to join the Felt, but the catch was that he genetically experimented on her. Only he knew how it worked, but he gave her an ability of her own. If she ever died, the universe would die with her. In so doing, Doc Scratch arranged for the end of the universe. She's an 8-ball, you sink her, everyone loses.
Mm-hmm. The Midnight Crew and the Felt had many altercations and killed each other often. However, due to the time shenanigans of the Felt, the dust never stopped the fighting. Everyone refrained from killing when the 8-Ball, now known as Snowman, was around. Except for Snowman, of course. She and Spade Slick had a relationship that oscillated between hatred and kismesitude.
606 sweeps in the future. The last Scrub meteor arrived very late, carrying Damara. Doc Scratch raised her since all trolls in Lusai were extinct. Her childhood was awful. Doc Scratch manipulated her, abused her, and had to forbid her from attempting suicide. He's literally like the devil of this world.
Yep. 612 sweeps in the future. The Connus eventually arrived at Alternia, but her species had been dead for centuries. However, the Handmaid appeared to her. With trolls dead, her time-traveling assassinations were completed. Lord English ordered the Handmaid to extend an employment opportunity to the Condess. The Condess killed the Handmaid, and in doing so, acquired the clockwork magic powers Lord English had gifted her. The Condess thus became enslaved as Lord English's servant for the next universe.
And, I mean, next universe, then she goes to Earth, remember?
Mm-hmm.
We talked about that in the last episode.
Mm-hmm.
Doc Scratch used his powers to construct portals in his apartment on the Green Moon. One led to the server with the Tildath code, one led to the Felt Manor on Alternia, one led to a higher dimension where the creator of Homestuck, Andrew Hussey, lived.
Doc Scratch invited Spade Slick to his place, where Doc Scratch ordered him to kill Snowman. At first he refused, but Doc Scratch used his green fire to scare Spade Slick into submission.
Hussey, sick of Doc Scratch taking over his story, smacked him with a broom, which was all it took to kill him. Damara tried to escape, but then Lord English captured her. He bestowed his clockwork magic onto her and named her his handmaid. He sent her back in time to have served him until now. He sent the Condess, his new servant, to the universe that the troll scrub players would create, to a particular planet called Earth, to prepare it for his arrival.
Spade Slick shot Snowman with Doc Scratch's gun, sinking his cue ball-like bullet into Snowman's eight-ball heart. Then the universe imploded into a singularity.
The only survivors from the A2 universe would be those who went into the scrub session, as well as those who escaped to Hussey's higher dimension. Hussey saved Spade Slick, not knowing Lord English followed behind.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to get into the main plot of it. But basically, that's the entire troll universe and where they came from. Mm-hmm. The surviving trolls are all that's left. Doc Scratch knew that Hussey would kill him, but that's who it took. It took the creator of Homestuck to kill Doc Scratch. It only took a whack of a broom, indicating Doc Scratch was actually a really fragile puppet the whole time.
Yeah.
But because of his omniscience, he had never been dealt a blow ever.
Yep.
Well, actually, no. Spade Slick did deal him a blow before.
Did he? Maybe only Hussey could ever do anything to him.
Yeah. Yeah, that's probably what it was.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, that's the troll story. We're out of time. Bye.
Bye.